So Jule Charney had very wide interests, and he contributed both in metrology and oceanography. And we thought it was important to represent oceanography at this meeting. And Mark Kane was scheduled to give us a talk on how you go from weather timescales to climate timescales, which fundamentally involves the ocean in some way. Unfortunately, Mark is unable to be with us. He's okay, but he's got a very bad cold and was unable to come up from Columbia University, where he's a professor. So I would like to thank our own Carl Wunsch for coming in at short notice, and he's going to be assisted by Joe Pedlosky, who I think we can claim is an oceanographer, as well as Carl. Now, Carl is a hugely influential person who was a colleague of both Charney and Lorenz. He's an emeritus professor here at MIT and has essentially been here for nearly 60 years. Is it 50? Yeah. And his own contributions are legion. He started out studying internal waves in the ocean and time series analysis. He's organized massive field programs, introduced inverse methods into oceanography, and in the last 10 or 20 years thought very much about the role of the oceans in climate. So we're going to have a tandem presentation. Over to you, Carl.
Well, thank you to speak to this. I'm not Mark Kane. I'm not going to pretend to be, but the organizers did think that it was important that people, particularly in an audience that knows Jule primarily from his meteorological work, to recognize that he actually was a very important presence in physical oceanography in particular. And he had at least two students who went on to very distinguished careers in oceanography. And well, I will leave some of the words of this somewhat ad hoc talk to Joe. Just to set a little bit the stage, in the memorial volume, which Dick Linson alluded to, Henry Stommel and Dennis Moore try to analyze the oceanographic influence on Jule, and they say, oh, yeah, it was Rossby, Mervinos, who was the main influence. But if you read the interview that he had with George Platzman, he says, oh, no, it was Harald Sverdrup there on the left, and Henry Stommel there on the right. Sverdrup was on the faculty at UCLA the time Jule was doing his thesis, because though he was director of Scripps, Scripps did not then give a degree of its own. And I believe that Harald was on his thesis committee. I'll do that. This has been said before. When he came to MIT from Princeton, Jule says in his interview, which, as Dick says, is very well worth reading, the Platzman interview, that almost the first thing he did was start this GFD seminar, originally Harvard, MIT, Woods Hole, and then it got a little bit looser after that. And you've all seen this before. This is a sketch by Henry Stommel of a notice of one of those GFD seminars, now much reproduced. It does give you something of the flavor of GFD circa 1959, 1960, at the time Jule first came. He'd been here a few years at that point. For those of you who can read it, it features three theories by Veronis, Charney, and Stommel, and of course, three anti-theories by Willem Malkus, which those of you who knew Willem, who died not long ago, makes a great deal of sense. And then, of course, down at the bottom, it says that Bob Arthur will actually talk about what the observations really show. These seminars were major events roughly every 2 weeks. They were well oiled by alcohol, at least, usually after the talks, not always, and were actually very important in the establishment of GFD and the connections with oceanography. There was, and I thought a little bit about this, there was a very heavy oceanographic component to what one can think of the origins, at least locally, of GFD. My suspicion has always been that it was because much less was known about the ocean, and there's huge advantages to theoreticians to work in subjects where there are no observations. And that's changed a bit over the years, but it's still probably true. Some of the things that Jule had done, this is not complete, Joe will add to this, but what I think he's best known for was his inertial theory of the Gulf Stream. Stommel in 1948 had explained the existence of the Gulf Stream as due to the variation of the Coriolis parameter with latitude. Sorry, a technical point that had been extended by Walter Monk. Stommel knew very well that, in fact, it was a very nonlinear phenomenon, but typical Stommel, he went looking for somebody with more mathematical skills than he thought he had himself. And there's an interesting story. There are two papers almost simultaneously, one by Jule, the other by Morgan, neither of which has Stommel's name on it, and that says it's a story itself. When Jule came to MIT, he was intrigued by this. It was about 1959, as you saw in the previous slide, the newly rediscovered equatorial undercurrent, and he did work on it, the theory alluded to in the previous slide, and then he had a postdoc in Stanley Spiegel and did a bit more than that. But probably the most important thing, I would argue, that Jule did for oceanography was he provided what Hank Coles called a refuge for him. As you see, he says he fled to MIT, where he had his friends, Star, Charney, Lorenz, and Phillips. Of course, as has actually been said here before, he was fleeing Harvard, and I will leave it to people to read about that in Hank's autobiography. As somebody who actually has a position now at Harvard, I would say, it's completely different. He could be very happy there now. And then Jule, in his interview, says this. After Stommel arrived at MIT, I thought I should leave oceanography to the oceanographers. And he kind of backed away, but not completely. He did actually go to sea a couple of times, once on a vessel called La Curieuse, which I don't know if anybody else in the room remembers. That's not a literal rendering of La Curieuse, but the people, Stommel was running a small boat operation out of the Seychelles up to the equator, and the students and postdocs who were told to go, and Jule did go, would come back with stories about it that made that seem like a reasonable rendering of what that work was like. I've often thought that Unols or OSHA would never permit anybody to run that kind of operation today. But again, that's yet another sea story, which I will go over. If I can be personal for just a second, because for me it was very important. The time Hank fled to MIT, I was a geophysics student studying things like geomagnetism and seismology, and the context of that was the most exciting period in the whole history of geophysics. It was the midst of the argumentation about plate tectonics and continental drift. And there may be a few people left in this audience who were at the symposium of the opening of the Green Building in 1964. And among other things, it featured major arguments between the dominant figures in plate tectonics about pro and con as to whether this actually existed. And but Raymond Hyde, who was mentioned, is actually a very important faculty member. He was not in the meteorology department. He was in what was then called geology and geophysics. He said, you ought to talk to this new faculty member. And what I would say is it's a lesson in a scientific charisma, because I never looked back. And I went to Hank, said, I don't know anything about the ocean. He said, it's much better that way. And we went on from there. So I have a very personal connection and in that. And Ray should not be forgotten either. This, I think, the last thing before I turn it over to Joe. Jule remained very interested in the ocean. He would talk about it with us all the time. The people on the 14th floor included down the hall people like Henry Stommel and George Veronis for a while, Victor Barcelon, and a series of visitors. This is a sketch of what the oceanographers will know of his first conception of what was called, eventually came to be called the mid-ocean dynamics experiment. And for those of you who don't know the history of this, this was a period of about 1970 in which we were all fully aware of Victor Starr's work on the importance of eddies in the atmosphere. There had been a few measurements made by people like Kreese and Swallow showing very strong oscillatory motions in the ocean, but what were beyond our technology. We also did know very well what Ed Lorenz had been saying. And everybody kind of knew intuitively that this ought to apply somehow to the ocean as well. So with this experiment, which did not ultimately look very much like Stommel's sketch, but which was presented, I remember the meeting was held in Jule Charney's office, sitting around the table, where Hank explained to the two of us that he thought the technology had arrived whereby oceanographers could actually begin to develop what have come to be called mesoscale, unfortunately, balanced eddies, geostrophic eddies, the ocean analog of weather. And Jule's opinion was very important in that. And this led to what today is the great blossoming of the study of the eddy field and related phenomena in the ocean, making the subject actually much more intimately connected to the atmosphere. And I think that's all. I will now turn it over to Joe to tell you what really happened.
So I love this. This is just like jazz. It's all improvisational. I was unprepared for this, and like good jazz, my solo should be short. So Carl mentioned some of Jule's contributions. I just want to expand on those briefly and mention one he didn't mention. But certainly he's best known in oceanography for his theory for the inertial model for the western boundary current, the Gulf Stream. This was really a big step forward because it finally produced a model that was not based on kind of imaginary frictional mechanisms to deal with the vorticity balances in the current. And he was very successful in coming up with a purely inertial and very realistic model for the Gulf Stream. And the key to his success in doing that was something that was very Charney-esque, I would say. It was conservation of potential vorticity. The potential vorticity is an extension of the idea of the circulation theorem and vorticity to include thickness changes of fluid columns. And Charney used that conservation principle, a kind of a beautiful application of a fundamental theorem in fluid mechanics, to with data, which he used on, for and to talk about what the flow looked like offshore of the Gulf Stream, to come up with a very, very realistic model of the Gulf Stream. Big triumph. It also had great implications because an inertial Gulf Stream, inertial boundary current, raised the question of what you needed to have in order to successfully have a inertial boundary current. And that led to some beautiful work by, we were talking about the interaction between this field and applied mathematics, a beautiful theorem by Harvey Greenspan on the necessary condition to have an inertial boundary current in terms of the general oceanic flow. And the implications of that and the interpretation of that and what you needed in order to hold the energy of the Western boundary current in against Rossby wave radiation really amplified our understanding of the inertial boundary current theory. So that was first and foremost a tremendous step forward. The other contribution that Jule made to oceanography very early, which has not been mentioned, was understanding the mid-ocean circulation as an interaction between the upper boundary layer, Ekman layer, and the flow and the region beneath that that was geostrophic. Prior to Jule's work on the wind-driven circulation of the ocean, the way that interior flow was dealt with was by integrating the whole circulation from the depths where you assumed nothing was taking place up to the very surface where the boundary condition was a condition of continuity of stress with the applied stress for the atmosphere. Jule showed how to separate the upper boundary layer, the flow in the upper boundary layer, from the geostrophic flow below that. And that led to a kind of a remarkable insight that allowed conceptually to think about part of the thermocline flow as being strictly geostrophic with no friction at all, coupled to this upper frictional boundary layer. I mention those two things because those ideas of a frictionless thermocline region, plus Jule's idea of conservation of potential vorticity, were exactly the ingredients that Hank Stommel, Jim Lawton, and I used to explain the circulation of the gyres and the thermal structure of the upper ocean. The third major contribution that Carl mentioned was the equatorial undercurrent. This is a wonderful story. The equatorial undercurrent was discovered in the 19th century and then forgotten because it was a current that is as swift as the Gulf Stream, broad as the Gulf Stream, 100 kilometers, flowing nearly a meter a second. But it is buried beneath an upper layer, so it's not easily seen. And for some reason, I can't imagine how, but it was forgotten and then was rediscovered in the 50s. And then there was this excitement and this competition of theories and so forth. And there were all kinds of theories. You saw the list of the names associated with them. At the time, the most sophisticated theory, and I think the one that was considered the most successful at the time, was Charney's inertial theory, nonlinear theory, that depended very much, however, on very sensitively on friction. It's not the model we would think of using now, but at the time, it represented a sophisticated view of what the dynamics ought to be. So I think I'll leave it with that and conclude my little solo and step off the stage.
Thanks a lot, Joe.